He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Okay, today we're going to look at this compound. We've got this alkyl bromide, and we're going to have this alkyl bromide undergo four different transformations. These are four different reaction conditions. We're going to want to try to see what we can get. So as a hint, we're going to want to maybe go back and look at my lectures on SN1, SN2, E1, E2, especially about choosing which mechanism is going to occur. Okay, so let's take a look at these four different reaction conditions and see if we can choose which mechanism is going to occur. On the first one here, remember that usually the first thing that we want to look at, especially considering these are all secondary substrates, so there's not too much information we're going to get there, we're going to want to look at the strength of the base or nucleophile. And so in this case, we have water. Water is not especially strong. Water is not going to have the capacity to directly attack as a nucleophile or anything like that. So from a weak base, we can rule out SN2 and E2. So if we've ruled out SN2 and E2, that means it's going to be SN1 or E1. Now, in order to choose which one is going to occur, a hint can usually be the temperature. And we know that because of the Gibbs free energy equation, that a colder temperature is going to favor substitution, whereas a hotter temperature is going to favor elimination. And so because this is weak and cold, we're going to go SN1. With this one. And so SN1, we know that the first step is going to be that the leaving group leaves. And so we get the carbocation there. And then what's going to happen is that we are probably going to get this hydride shift, right? And so we'll get this guy here. And there's our carbocation. And then water is going to be able to come in. And after it deprotonates, we will get that tertiary alcohol there. So there is our SN1 product. Now, let's go ahead and look at the next one here. Tert butoxide, that is our dead giveaway E2. We know that tert butoxide is always going to do E2. That is because it is a very strong base. So it has the capacity to push this molecule around. It's going to do something. It's going to react. It doesn't have to wait for a carbocation. So it's either going to do E2 or SN2. But because of how bulky that tert butyl group is, there's too much steric hindrance associated with this molecule going ahead and coordinating or doing SN2. So we know that tert butoxide is always going to do E2. Now, furthermore, it has two options in terms of which protons it's going to grab. There's three protons over here, and there's one proton over there. So there's potentially two different elimination products. And so we're comparing the Zaitsev and the Hoffman elimination products. But we know that because of the steric hindrance of that base, it is going to have a much easier time, it's going to have a much lower activation energy associated with approaching one of these protons at the edge of the molecule, and therefore forming the Hoffman elimination product. Okay, so once again, that is because of the strength of the base that we know that's either E2 or SN2, the steric hindrance that we know that it is elimination over substitution, and then once again the steric hindrance that caused us to grab this more sterically available proton than the one in the interior of the molecule. So that's number two. Let's look at the third one. Now, once again, we've got water. Now that's going to be, again, that's weak, so we're ruling out SN2 and E2. We're going to be looking at SN1 and E1. Now, in this case, we're looking at a hot temperature. Once again, because eliminations are entropically unfavorable, that entropic favorability is going to go up as the temperature increases, and so hot temperatures are going to favor elimination. We think that this one is going to be an E1 reaction. So once again, E1 means we're going to first go ahead and have the leaving group leave. So there's our carbocation. Once again, probably this hydride shift is going to occur, right? And so here we have that. And then we said that E1 is going to occur, once again, because of the temperature. And so water is going to get to go ahead and choose a proton to extract. Now, in this case, instead of Hoffman, because of how sterically hindered tert butoxide is, Water is a small molecule, so it has access to these protons on these methyls, or it has access to a proton over here. And because thermodynamics favors a more substituted alkene, we are, in this case, going to probably predominantly get the Zaitsev elimination product. So that is the more substituted of the possible alkenes. We could have had the double bond there or there, but instead we have it there because that is a tri-substituted alkene as opposed to a possible di-substituted alkene. So there is our E1 product. And now lastly, as we can probably guess, we haven't done SN2 yet, and as it happens, the CN minus nucleophile is an excellent SN2 nucleophile. And so that one is going to go ahead and just do direct SN2. And we know that SN2 always occurs with inversion of stereochemistry, so that has to be on the dash bond there. So there we have our four reaction conditions. Weak and cold is going to give us SN1. This is strong and sterically hindered, so we've got E2. This is weak and hot, so we've got E1. And then we know that this is a strong nucleophile. This is an excellent SN2 nucleophile. So there are the four reactions that we've got on this substrate. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.